I just turned 60 years old, and this is Rack of the Week number 60.
Well, isn't that special?
Hello, my name is Bob. Welcome to A Shortstop on Pool. The rack starts with a pretty typical break shot. I'm a little bit far away, and the object ball is a little bit far away from the rack, so I'm not going to power stroke this one. You can see I'm aiming low on the cue ball, probably just hoping the cue ball comes to the side rail. Yeah, just like that. So great. That's a great result. I got a bonus ball that fell into this pocket over here. Let's take a look at the rack, do a little bit of rack analysis. This is a great result, especially considering that I didn't power into the rack. There's only four balls in the rack area. That's great. The balls are spread really well. I've got an obvious, very simple shot to start right here in this bottom right corner pocket. There's only one really problem area, and it's not much of a problem, is these two balls on the side rail. So the question is how to proceed from here. I think every straight pool player in the world is going to shoot this stripe ball into the bottom right corner to start. Now, it'd be a natural positional route to send the cue ball into these balls to try and open them up. The problem is there's no insurance ball. If you had a ball in this area, or perhaps even, well, no, probably just this area, then you'd have a case to be made that there's an insurance ball and that'd be a reasonable shot. In this instance, I think that these two balls on the side rail are your priority, and there's no better shot right now than to cut this ball in the corner and send the cue ball over here to open those balls up. Before you do so, though, you want to make a decision, because your cue ball could either come to the rail below them or directly into the five, or you might even choose to go into the bottom side of the five or the top side, or it could go into the stripe ball. So what's going to serve you best? Either going to the rail or the bottom side of the five ball, I think it would be the best. You want to open these balls up, but you also want to contain the cue ball. This nine ball is your insurance ball for running into these two balls along the rail. So you don't need to get reckless. You don't need it hard. You're just trying to create a little bit of separation in these balls, the five and the 13, and have hopefully the cue ball will stay here so you have a shot on the nine ball. So let's see how that turns out. I believe that I was aiming for the rail below the five ball. But I kind of hit it full, maybe towards the low side of the five. But this is an excellent result. Notice I didn't have to hit it hard. Plenty of separation, and I've got a shot on the nine. It's at this point you can see me eyeballing elsewhere in the rack, though. And that's because you always want to take a look at your priorities. So I need to shoot the nine ball at some point, because that's going to clear the pocket for the 13 later on. But now that that problem's been solved, this is the next problem to solve, this cluster in the center of the table. It wouldn't be a bad idea to shoot the 9 and draw the cue ball back here to have a shot on the 14 in this corner pocket, in order to open this small cluster. But when you have position, generally you want to use it and don't try to shoot another shot and get that position once again. If you already have it, why not use it? The other thing that I notice is that I've got one potential break ball, probably two, the 8 and the 6. The 8's a little high. The 6 is a little bit low on the outside. But both are very workable, so manufacturing a break ball isn't a high priority. We're also doing something that's a little bit unusual in that there's a basic rule of straight pool that says you want to work from the outside in. That would mean that I'd want to shoot the 1, 15, 13, and 9, clear the outside, and then shoot the inside balls. In this case, I don't think that's all that big of a priority, because these balls are going to be open to either the lower corner pockets. Additionally, the one ball or the 15 are in key ball position, so I'm inclined to not shoot those until I've solved this center area of the table. So in this instance, for those two reasons, it's probably best to shoot the 14 ball right now. Once again, I don't need to hit this hard, just hard enough for the cue ball to run into the 3 or the 2, and just open these up a little bit more. I believe that the 5 back in this side pocket and possibly the 9 in this corner pocket will be insurance balls on that shot. So let's see how this turns out. That's a beautiful shot. I consider this rack solved now. All the balls are wide open. And you saw me walk over to this side of the table. I think the obvious shot to shoot next would be the five ball on the side. You could shoot this two ball. Some people might want to shoot it and run into these balls, but they're open. We no longer need to run into any balls. And then what I've noticed is this rack, the end pattern almost shoots itself. And why do I say that? It's because I've got another break ball. So one of these three are going to be my break ball. And then I've got a good key ball in the three or the one. Probably the one is the best key ball. So the balls that I've marked are the ones that I'm going to be thinking about saving for a moment. And I need to shoot these other balls. Well, what ball gets me on my key ball? You look diagonally from the key ball. It's the 13. So I think the 13 is going to be my K2. Notice what I'm doing is I'm eliminating balls to shoot now. These are balls I want to save for later. So I'm going to shoot the 5. Probably the next ball to shoot is the 9. And what I see is this. I have a little bit of a shooting gallery, and that's these four balls. All four of those balls are open to this pocket. Now, some people would look at this table and see this as kind of a cluster, kind of a problem, but I don't. I want to play short side position. I want to get my cue ball over here. Because from here, the 3 ball goes in the side, this 4 ball goes in this side, the 4, the 8, the 7, and the 6 all go in this lower left corner pocket. I might even end up shooting the 1 ball in the corner, but probably not. But short side position, and once you shoot one or two of these balls, all of a sudden, the remaining balls are going to be open. So that's what I see. I'm going to shoot the 5 ball next, and I want to play position to get my cue ball here, preserving the balls that I mark. So how do I do that? You go 5, 9, 2, because it's very natural to go from the 2 ball right there. So this is a 3-shot sequence, 5, 9, 2. That's something you want to identify. And then I saw quickly when I was shooting this rack. Very simple shots, 100% reliable positional routes to get short side. So let's go ahead and get short side on those balls and then see what opportunities present themselves. Notice that I didn't get straight in on the 9. If you had rolled the cue ball forward to here, now you have a hard time getting the cue ball off this rail to get a shot on the 2 ball. But with the angle that I had, it's child's play to just let it bounce off the rail and get an angle that you need on the 2 ball to get short side. So that cue ball came up a little bit high, and I think I did that on purpose. And now that I've watched this from playing this a couple weeks ago, the reason why I did it, I was playing position for the 3 ball, because the 3 ball does go in this corner pocket. Now, if I had landed short, like here, then I've got a shot on one of these 3 balls. And if I had come farther, hopefully I don't come behind the 1, but if I come a little bit farther, I could still shoot the 3, or I could shoot the 4 ball. So rather than playing position to this area where I mentioned earlier, I was specifically looking at getting that 3 ball out of there. And that's good strategy as well. That's kind of related to the top-down strategy that I've been talking about lately. So at this point, obviously, I've decided to shoot the 8 ball in the same pocket as the 3 that I just shot. And you see me walking around and taking a quick look. The rest of the pattern for the rest of the rack is already there, and I'm wondering if you see it. A stop shot on the 8 ball gets you on this 4. I really want to get the 6 has got to go out, got to be cleared sooner rather than later because it blocks the break ball. And that's the worst position zone is this area below the break ball. If you have a ball in that zone below your break ball, you want to get rid of it early. So I'm going ahead and shooting the 8, and I'm going to shoot the 4 as well because I could shoot the 8 and then shoot the 6, but how do I get on the 4? Whereas if I shoot the 8 and then the 4, it's a simple matter to just draw the cue ball back 3 inches and I have a shot on the 6 ball. So I'm seeing another 3-shot pattern, 8-4-6. Once that's done, I'll have this angle on the 6 ball. And what I saw when I rewatched this video was what I think the best positional route is 2 rails below the 13 back to center table. Because from here I can shoot the 15 and then I have 15, 13, 9. Obviously, I want to shoot the 13 and then the 1. 15, 13, 1, I meant to say. 1 is the cue ball. The 9's already gone. That's what I see when rewatching this, and I play this a little bit different. So let's get Bob shooting here. This was a stop shot, and the cue ball actually drifted down a little bit on purpose to make sure that I've got the right angle to draw back over here to get on that 6. Now, here's where I would definitely play for above center table, because it's a very simple matter to get on the 15. You saw me hesitate there for a second. I was looking at my angle. I'm actually playing position for the 13 here, and I don't like that. How much harder would this rack have been, or this end pattern have been, if on that positional shot that I just shot, if the cue ball bumped the 15 and stopped right here? Now I'm tree-topped over the 15. Now I've got to shoot this ball while I'm elevated over the 15, and then I've got to hope that I get the right angle to shoot the 15 in the corner because I can't do anything with the cue ball. So I think this was a bad decision. Much better to come over here and shoot the 15 next. You can get a variety of angles. You know, you can be high or straight in or even low on the 15 and still get a real good shot on the 13. And all you have to do when you pocket the 13 is get the cue ball to come up a little bit off the rail, and you're good. You're good to go. So I think this was a mistake. And now I need to draw the cue ball back to that center table position and hope that I don't get too much angle on the 15, because then it'll be too hard to get on the 1. If I ended up low, like here, then I've got to send the cue ball 3 rails around the top of the table, and that's not a desirable thing. As it is, I could cheat the pocket and get real good on the cue ball shot. So it worked out in this instance, but that's something to watch for. A little bit of left English just checks the cue ball, the angle of the cue ball, and the speed. And I've got a real good inside angle on this 7-ball break shot. The cue ball's inside of the 7-ball. Here's the parallel line. It's on the inside. So I'm going to hit this with a follow stroke, a high cue ball. I'm hitting the lower part of the rack, so I would expect the cue ball to go to the bottom rail. And I'm not going to, once again, I think I'm not powering this ball, but a medium firm stroke with a high cue ball. Yeah, interesting. So in this instance, the cue ball hit this rack ball very full, and instead of curving to the bottom rail, it backed up and then went forward again. And maybe I'll play that in slow motion so we can watch it. And then the other thing we should look for is secondary collision balls. So in this instance, I would expect this stripe ball to go to the bottom rail and back up. And just like last week, perhaps the 5-ball will go to the side rail and back. Let's watch the break shot again and see what happens. Amazing how predictable these things are, isn't it? If I'm not to 10,000 subscribers yet, be sure to watch this video and enter the giveaway. Thanks for watching.